Thanks very much, guys, for attending this session. So my name is Cristian. Most of you know me. I guess I'm a software architect working for Intel. My contributions are around the table lookup algorithms, around the quality of service libraries, and around the packet framework and P4 support in DPDK. So I was supposed to present this session on how to run P4 programs as DPDK applications together with my colleague, my Intel colleague Han. He's actually sound asleep right now. He's on a time zone that basically it's the middle of the night for him right now. So I'll present this on his behalf as well. He's a compiler architect at Intel. He's working on enabling basically DPDK and CPU as a P4 target into the P4C open source compiler. Can we go to the next slide, please? So basically what we try to do here is we try to add the CPU as a target for P4. We are trying to provide support for running P4 programs on the CPU. Usually P4 comes from the switch world, right? It comes from P4 is the program to use to program the Intel Tofino multi-terabit switch that runs like in data centers. And some people will definitely ask, why do we need to run P4 on the CPU? Is this just a simulator just to make the switch guys happy and basically provide a debug environment for them? And the answer is definitely no. This is basically a software framework for a software implementation of data plane programs that are described in P4. Because why P4? Because we think P4 will bring you a lot of advantages, right? So that's what it is. It's a software framework to run P4 programs on multi-core CPUs. The goal is to be able to develop better and faster virtual switches or software switches by combining the flexibility that and the rich feature set to describe data plane that P4 introduces as a language. Combining that with the performance that we get in DPDK. On DPDK side, we know how to write software on the CPU and on the NICs, how to offload the stuff to the NIC as well, in order to basically get great performance on the server side. So what I really want to tell people is that this is actually a real project. This is not just slideware. This project that I tend to call P4 DPDK because it combines both the communities, the P4 community and the DPDK community. This is a real project and it has real deliverables. You may have seen lots of patches in DPDK related to P4. There is also a code on p4.org. So some people from DPDK world might ask, okay, we saw a lot of C patches, but where is the P4? Well, it's actually a split project, if you want. There is a P4C compiler. This is an open source compiler frontend, really, which handles the first layers, peels the first layers of the P4 onion when you write a program. This is there on GitHub at this link that we have on the screen. We also have code in DPDK. Basically, we took the pipeline library and refactored, redesigned it pretty much inside out in order to align to P4, to the P4 feature set, in order to be able to describe clearly and efficiently a data plane for the CPU. So we have this pipeline library that is pretty much the engine of P4 in DPDK. We also have the reference target agent, and I'll explain in a second what that is. It's basically an application that needs to load your P4 program, or actually the equivalent of the P4 program, because as you'll see, we are actually translating the P4 program. That's the job of the compiler. into an intermediate representation file that we call .spec file in DPDK. And basically the target agent will just load this this spec file that is pretty much the P4 program translated, simplified for the CPU to load. We load that on this target application, and then we run it. We call the engine to run that that program and pretty much crunch packets, and also wait for the control plane to hook up with us and populate the tables and map keys to actions and provide the data for those actions. So again, the message is this project is real. It would be great if you guys would actually go and take a look and start using it. And we are very grateful for any findings that you might have while porting your programs, writing P4 programs, running them on the CPU with this tool. Finally, we have a tool to do that. It will be great to get your findings and your contributions, of course, in terms of bug fixing, in terms of patches with the new features. Next slide, please. So just a couple of slides on why P4 for the CPU. Why CPU as a target for P4? And one point to make here is that pretty much P4 is a language for switches, but there is nothing that says P4 is the language only for hardware switches. In fact, all these applications, all the switchy applications on the that we run on the CPU, whether it's a BNG or a UPF or a firewall data plane side, or I don't know, a security gateway, all this basically is can be described as a switch pipeline. So then, therefore, it could be described in P4. So pretty much in a data center, you'll find the big iron switches that are multi-terabit per second switches. The CPUs, obviously, are the younger, the smaller brothers of those switches. So they typically, the CPU will only handle below 1 terabit per second in terms of traffic. But why not put them together? So basically, you could have a pipeline that runs on the switch and then spills over to the servers, right? It can spill over to smart NICs, it can spill over to the CPU. So it is definitely more efficient, and you get also better integration between all these switches if you could describe all these switches in a common environment under P4, right? And then you could have this target agent. Every switch also has a CPU, right? And this CPU is there to wait for the control plane to connect and configure the switch, populate the tables. So that CPU on the switch is typically running what we call a target agent. We could have the same on the smart NICs. We have CPU cores over there for connectivity in control plane, maybe for data plane as well. And on the CPU, as well, we have so many cores, we can use some for control plane, and we could use them to basically run this target agent, wait for connectivity from control plane, and then use most of them to run the data plane application, crunch the packets from receive from network interfaces. Now the control plane that sits on top of all this, which is the SDN controller, pretty much. Is communicating with these data plane agents, these switches, whether they're software or hardware, through a protocol that is part of the P4 family. It's called P4 runtime. This is pretty much message passing that comes from the controller to the target agent and back as well. So one operation is to load a program from the controller, a P4 program from the controller to the target agent, which is pretty much program the target. The target is initially blank. It doesn't know anything about any protocol. It doesn't know what IPv4 is. It doesn't know what the Ethernet is. It doesn't know anything about what to do with those packets. The tables are also empty initially, so you will just get lookup missing the tables until they get populated with keys and action data. So that's the job of the controller, to load the target, program the target pretty much, and then the target will start crunching packets efficiently, and then the control plane will also poll the target from time to time to get the statistics. It will also populate these tables. I think I mentioned that a couple of times. So that's one way to benefit on the CPU side from P4. Next slide, please. Another way where P4 could be useful is by building better network stacks, right? And this might be a very bold statement. It's about building better network switches that are more, building better software switches, virtual switches that are more flexible, because the idea is that the description of a P4 program, the P4 description of the data plane is much shorter. It's just a few hundred lines of P4 code. I didn't see P4 code, P4 programs. I've seen very big P4 programs that do a lot of things that basically describe how to program a data center switch, and they don't exceed 4,000 or 5,000 lines of P4 code. So that would be the equivalent of a few millions of lines of code in C on any stack that you'd like. It's the equivalent of many. Probably millions lines of RTL code in case you want to program your FPGA, right? So how is that going to go? So basically, you just use P4 to describe the header processing. You want to describe your data plane in P4 and basically keep the data plane short and crisp by describing it in P4. Keep all the header processing as part of the P4 program that is loaded by your P4 switch, whether it's a virtual switch or a hardware switch. And then obviously there are blocks around the switch that are part of any application that might not be or are likely not able to, not suitable for description in P4. Whether it's cryptography, whether it's a video optimization, traffic management, application identification, DPI, lawful intercept, TCP termination, firewall DPI, pretty much, firewall, whatever heuristics that are there, TCP proxy, TLS proxy, all these things obviously are not header processing operations. They cannot be described with just headers and metadata and with the tables and actions. So then you can simply code them, extract them and code them as components that are connected to this switch. They might be some external components. This is the terminology in P4, and you could access them through an interface that you have to declare in P4, but not express the functionality in P4. Or they could simply be devices connected to the ports of this virtual switch, right? So then P4, the P4 virtual switch is connected to all these accelerators, whether they are NICs or hardware accelerators for cryptography or everything else, traffic management maybe. And is also connected to maybe some other processes or some other libraries that do all these other components, whether they are VNFs or instantiation that you have there. Classification, ACLs, FIBs, tunnels, NAT, meters, markers, stats, all these operations that are pretty much data plane operations, that they can be described very efficiently in P4. So then keep them in P4. And this is also a nice way to decouple between disaggregate between the data plane that is described in P4 and the control plane that communicates with the data plane, configures the data plane through this protocol, which is called P4 runtime. On top of this protocol, which is part of the P4 family, you could have network operating systems, you could have PFCP for wireless, you could have SONIC, you could have OVSDB, why not? So this is basically another way to make use of the goodness of P4 on the CPU side. Next slide, please. Now, I do have a slide on the feature set of P4 DPDK. I mean, what I want to show to people is that this is a very comprehensive framework that provides support for a lot of the features that are part of the P4 language, and part of P4 runtime, and part of the portable switch architecture, PSA, which is pretty much like the equivalent of a standard library when you try to find a correspondent for the people that know the C language, right? which is what we pretty much know how to use in DPDK. So P4 allows you to describe a switch. That's pretty much what it is. Now that switch sits on top of I/O, right? So that's why I mean, it's a great match with DPDK, because DPDK, one of the key strengths of DPDK is to provide a fast packet I/O into the CPU. So we support basically these switch ports. They could be NIC I/O ports, pretty much the DPDK POLMO drivers. They could be ring buffers, in circular buffers in memory on top of RTE ring. They could be a tap port or any type of socket or file descriptor. We also support PCAP files. We also have a drop port. So the way we drop the packets here on this target is simply by having a dedicated port that will only do packet drop. So whenever we want to drop packets, we pretty much send them to that output port and the packets get dropped. Obviously, all the other output ports are doing meaningful stuff like packet forwarding. The switch, as pretty much people know, P4 sits on top of headers. So we do support defining headers from scratch. We do support defining metadata. That's pretty much what the P4 program is doing. Uses the match action units, basically tables and actions, to define how to transform the packet headers and the packet metadata, right? So we do have support for that. And for the match action units, pretty much we need to support different lookup algorithms. And we do support exact match tables. We do support wildcard match tables. We use the DPDK Liberty or the DPDK ACL library. That's basically our engine for wildcard match and LPM as well. We just send patches for to support the LPM tables on top of this library. So basically, we could color this this box, the next box, the LPM table, we could color it to blue. We also support this action selector, which is a key feature in the portable NIC architecture. In the portable switch architecture on p4.org. It's pretty much a way to implement a complex FIB, a complex routing data plane side of the routing table with ECMP support or weighted CMP support, and as well with the VRF support. So virtual routing and forwarding, basically have multiple logical routing tables into the single physical routing table, like one per subscriber, for example. So we just sent patches that got integrated a few days ago for supporting the action selector in our DPDK backend. We do have support for actions and basically the pipeline describing the life of the packet is done through a pipeline construct, which is the equivalent of an apply block in P4, or the apply block of a control block in P4. And it's based on instructions as well as actions. The actions that execute whenever you look up a key in the table and you have a lookup hit, you identify an action and a single action that is associated with that key to run, and that will do all the work for the packet, for that table. Those are built using instructions. So we pretty much, the compiler actually, the P4 compiler in this intermediate representation file is translating all the constructions, all the, let's say, if the analysis of the P4 program into a stream of instructions. So instead of having if then else, we have jumps. We have instructions for pretty much a header extraction, header emission, table lookups, and everything else that you find in P4 and you execute on packet is done through these instructions, which is probably the big novelty of all this. We do have support for registers, for meters. We do support checksums. We do support, we do have a target agent, which is the pipeline application. We do have this spec file, which is an intermediate representation of the P4 programs. We know how to map pipelines to CPU. We can instantiate many pipelines, and then we can map multiple of them to the same CPU core. We have lots of CPU cores, or we can map each pipeline to a different CPU core. We can do that. We have a command line interface for the target agent, just to for demo purpose, really. And we do have plans to get better performance, which is yellow. We do have plans to get better better documentation. We want to write more use cases to validate our tool, and many other good things, and a few question marks in case people will discover other things that we need to do. Next slide, please. So just a few questions or a few details on how to answer a few questions on how P4DPDK really works. It's basically a two-stage process, as I try to describe up to this point. We have the first stage is an offline process where you simply use the P4C compiler to translate this P4 file into a .spec file. And then you have a runtime, an execution phase, the second phase, which is you have to connect to the target. Basically, this application, the pipeline application that runs on the CPU, you have to start it. And then this application really waits for a controller to connect to it. And of course, this is just a demo side, a demo target agent. We can improve it. We need to do a lot of work here to improve it, including adding support for P4 runtime protocol. Right now, we just have a local CLI. It's actually not a local CLI. It's a network CLI that sends strings through the network, but it's not really the P4 runtime protocol. That's TBD on our list. So a controller will just connect to this target, provide a spec file, and then the target will start to chew up that spec file to create all the data structures, to create everything that the pipeline needs in terms of allocating memory, creating data structures, connecting them together. So nothing unusual so far. It's just when you start the pipeline, once you map the pipeline that was successfully built to a CPU thread, then the pipeline starts executing and starts processing packets. Obviously, the tables are empty at this point. The pipeline knows everything about protocols at this point, but it also needs the external controller to connect to the target agent and populate these tables. So that's how it works. And then controller could pull statistics and do add more table updates. So that's pretty much how it works. One key point to say here is that we do have a fancy algorithm for updating tables, so we don't stop the data plane. All these pipelines that run on different CPU cores, whenever we need to update the tables, whether it's an exact match table as part of that pipeline, and by the way, each pipeline could run a different P4 programs, or you could have multiple pipelines running the same P4 program. That's both are supported. And then pretty much from time to time, the controller will say, hey, I want to add these routes to this pipeline, to the routing table, or I want to change these next hops. I want to change the details of the output Ethernet header for this route. Or I do want to add more flows, support more flows in my program, or whatever else. Any change of the tables, that's how you do stuff, is pretty much you program tables. That requires an update on the data plane. So what we do is we actually have a mirror copy for each table, and we will update those mirror copies for those tables. We will do that pretty much offline without disturbing the data plane. The data plane doesn't know that there is something, there is an update in progress. If that update is successful on all the tables for a specific pipeline, then yes, we just go and we swap a pointer. We pretty much give the data plane another array of pointers for all the tables it needs. And that's it. We just swap a pointer to an array of other pointers, which are the table handles. That's how we do things. So that allows to have a very good control plane update rate, right? Because you don't have to stop the data plane. You just swap a pointer at some point whenever you're ready on the next packet boundary. The next packet will be tagged with a new pointer to the tables. That's pretty much how it works. The previous packets that are still in flight can still use the old pointer to the tables. We wait until there is no packet that still uses the old tables, and then we say write commit, and then we also do the work on the mirror copy. The previous mirror copy that is now basically the previous mirror copy of the tables is now the main copy that the data plane uses. And then the old main copy is now the mirror copy, is the copy that is not used by the data plane. Let's call it the offline copy. And then you basically implement the same operations on those tables, the same updates on those tables, and you keep them in sync. And at this point, we have a fancy way to detect, okay, these changes cannot fail. There is no memory allocation at that time, so or any other thing, no resources that you need to get. So then this will not fail. And then you are happy to proceed and complete the updates. And pretty much it's a transactional process. This transaction could fail. So for various reasons. For example, you want to you have multiple tables and you want to operate changes in several of them. And maybe one entry that somebody wants to add to one of the tables is actually wrong. It has the wrong format. Or you don't have enough memory to perform the update, so then you could fail. So then you roll back all these steps that you started. You know that you can roll them back. You know that you can roll back anything that could fail. You have to make sure that you could roll back, and you don't need to worry about those steps that cannot fail. There are some things that cannot fail, and then you're happy to proceed with those after you decided that you fixed everything that could have possibly failed. But if it did, you have to revert. If it didn't, you can proceed. So that's pretty much how it works. And then maybe next slide, please. We do have a call to action to you guys as well. We need your help. It would be great, as I was also saying in my introduction, to get your help to review this code and port your application. Start using this tool, right? For now, for the first time, we do have a P4 compiler for the CPU. Please start write P4 programs. Please build them, compile them for the CPU, run them on the CPU, play with it. See what performance you're getting. It's basically measured in millions of packets per second for every CPU core that we use, and see what you find. Maybe you find maybe everything is great, which is what will happen in most of the cases, hopefully. If you find issues, if you have comments about how to improve things, let us know, and obviously we'll appreciate we definitely appreciate a lot any help that we might get from the community in fixing issues, in providing more features. Thank you. And now I'm more than happy to take questions. We still have 6 minutes. Maybe everything was perfect and we don't have any questions. Q&A tab. Okay, cool. I was looking in the chat tab. Okay, first question from Thomas. How P4 pipeline performance compares with the static L3 forward example? We don't compete with the L3 forward example. L3 forward example is extremely simple. And it's pretty much a synthetic test case, which is just a way to measure the performance of packet I/O. So our performance is not that great, but on the other hand, we do touch those packets. So the L3 forward is great when you don't have to do anything on the packet, but when you have to do anything on the packet, you need to start writing code. You need to start touching the packet, touching cache lines, looking up keys into tables, getting data from there, performing the actions. And that is actually a lot of work. If you want to write that by yourself from scratch, please go ahead. You might do better than our framework, although I'm not convinced, but it will take you a very, very, very long time. And that's why it's actually much shorter to write it in P4. So I prefer to compare pretty much with complex use cases, right? If you want to implement a UPF or a BNG in DPDK from scratch or in other framework, that's pretty much the way to compare our pipeline performance against that. On the other hand, yeah, I think we do get decent performance. I don't want to give the wrong signal. I think we do get decent performance at this point, and we do have plans to get a better performance, which we are going to start executing soon. Question from Thomas. What is duration of the full chain from compiler to controller agent messaging and effective data plane? So that's actually, I mean, what I can tell you at this point is like, you can get this spec file and you load it and you can start the pipeline application with one of the example spec files from there. It takes you, I don't know, maybe seconds, maybe less than that. It's about how many printfs you do there. I don't think it takes too much to load it. Now, if you want to have big programs, yeah, it might take a bit longer, but it's I think at this point is measured in seconds. It's what we do pretty much is just allocating memory and building data structures, connecting pointers together. That's pretty much what we do. And I don't think there is a big latency. And then that's just a one-off. You just do that when you start the application. Now, when you do connect at runtime to basically load reprogram tables, then as I was describing, this is pretty much you do the updates on the mirror copy. You do that for multiple updates together, so you don't have to do it for every key that you update. You basically do batches of keys that you maybe some keys you want to delete from a table, some keys you want to add to the same table or to other table, some other keys you want to modify to yet another table. So all this together, it's up to the controller how the controller wants to do that. The controller could coalesce, could batch multiple updates into the pipeline. So then that's pretty much pretty fast because then you just swap the pointer. So I hope that that answers the next question on how fast the pipeline tables can be updated dynamically. It's actually tricky how to define a benchmark. I would love to have a unit test maybe to define a benchmark and just have an auto test to just print. It took this many seconds to update the table. Or milliseconds or whatever, but it's tricky because it depends on what you try to do. Is it you want to update 1,000 flows at once, which provides you a great update rate, or is it that you want to update 1,000 flows one at a time, which basically would require 1,000 updates? So it depends on how you batch those things. If you could batch more work together, then it will be much faster and less interruption for the data plane. Question from Chris: are there any real-world commercial examples of P4 DPDK in practice today? Chris, we just started. The first DPDK release with support for basically alignment with P4 was 2008, so 1 year ago, and we were still missing a lot of features. For example, right now we just implemented the action selector from. I know that you are an expert into the PSA specification, so that's what we did, and we just aim to have compliance with the P4 language by the end of the year, and maybe with the standard library of P4 PSA, basically implement all those externs from there, support them in our tool by the end of the year as well. So then we'll have a better measure sometime soon, right? How people are going to use it, are they going to deploy it or not? So that's pretty much the measure of success. So hopefully within the next few quarters, we'll have a better idea and we'll have more data to provide an answer to your question. I see another question from Slava. Are there some plans to implement harder offload of P4 VM? So it's a great question, but I don't think we need to think about this for this tool. P4 has this quality as well, that the offload is done in a very elegant way. You don't need the CPU for anything other than load the P4 program on the target. So what you have to do, Slava, is just write a P4 program for either the CPU or the smart NIC of your choice, or the FPGA of your choice, or the switch of your choice, right? And then just load that program on your device. You don't need the CPU to do any partial offload. It's pretty much a full offload solution. So this is pretty much what we do, is enabling the CPU as a target, but you can definitely start the work to enable P4 on your smart NICs or DSPs or GPUs or any other device of your choice. By without basically needing a partial offload API in DPDK. I think that's great. How can I take it for a test drive? That's from Ajit. It's very, very good question. Just need to go to the first slide of this presentation. Just Google for P4C. That's the P4 compiler. Just download that Git and build the compiler front end from there. And also download DPDK, build DPDK, start the pipeline application. Well, then you need to write yourself a P4 program, need to pass it through the compiler, get the spec file, and then just send that spec file to the pipeline application. That's pretty much how it goes. Should be straightforward, but we do aim to provide a better documentation, a better getting started guide, or provide one, because we don't really have any at this point. We just have information scattered all over the place, which I think is not great. And we need to provide better examples and more examples to people. Did I miss any question? I think we answered all the questions. Yeah, if there are no more questions, or if there is any other question, feel free to contact me on email, right? Or on dev@dpdk.org or users@dpdk.org or my email. Or LinkedIn or any other way. Otherwise, thanks very much, guys. It was great to be here at DPDK Summit, and hope to see and talk to you again soon. Thanks very much.